May I now request Mr. Hemant Narulkar to give the introductory remarks.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Sunita Reddy, Dr. Mupen, Dr. Reddy, Dr. Devi Prasad Shetty, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to have you all with us in this special session on national health security, a topic which is very pertinent today. We are privileged to have a panel where each member has personally contributed significantly and greatly during the crisis, COVID crisis this year and last year. Ms. Sunita Reddy, many thanks for agreeing to moderate this session. You run India's largest private healthcare network that includes 71 hospitals and more than 400 pharmacies. During the COVID pandemic, your group has delivered exemplary services. We are aware that you have personally driven real-time analytics to know supply-demand mismatch of critical resources like ICU beds and critical medicines. It is great to have someone with your knowledge and experience. Dr. Mupen, it's a pleasure to have you with us. An outstanding healthcare entrepreneur, you are leading one of the growing chains in hospitals, in clinics and pharmacies. While based in Dubai, you have made a stellar contribution to healthcare in India. Thank you for joining us. Dr. Shetty, many thanks for agreeing to do this session. You are renowned for building an outstanding healthcare chain with a special focus on affordable cardiac care and micro health insurance. Your thought-provoking views on medical, nursing, and paramedical education and regulation deserve immediate consideration to address our healthcare crisis. The government has recognized your contribution by awarding you Padma Shri. It is our pleasure to have you and a very warm welcome to you. Professor Reddy, thank you for joining us. As a president, Public Health Foundation of India, your opinion has vital importance in dealing with public health emergencies such as the one which we have faced last year and a half. You have been a distinguished head of Department of Cardiology at India's premier healthcare research institute, All India Management Medical Sciences. It's our pleasure to have you and a warm welcome to you. Ladies and gentlemen, if there is one positive outcome out of this pandemic, it is that India has woken up to the need of decent and dependable healthcare system.
So,
irony is that the economic growth and recovery has we have had a great economic growth and recovery, but it has not kept pace with the healthcare expenditure. The emergence and growth of private healthcare has greatly improved the availability and quality of healthcare, particularly in cities. Yet its services remain far short of what nearly 1.4 billion people need, especially when they need healthcare at the same time. This reality has hit us very badly, and there is a newfound drive to dramatically raise the scale of healthcare through public and private investment. The cruel shortage of public healthcare during the pandemic has cost the country dearly in terms of both life and economy. Regrettably, a huge number of lives were lost prematurely. In absence of enough public healthcare facilities, government had no option but to resort to lockdowns. This has devastatingly impacted our economy. India has lost nearly 2 years of economic growth. Before the pandemic, the focus was more on making health insurance available to everyone. The assumption that not everybody would need healthcare at the same time has come back to bite us. We have learned that we need a healthcare system that expands quickly when required. The government has taken steps for emergency care, and it has been trying to shore up production and stocks of respiratory care materials, medicine, and equipment. The industry, which took production cuts to divert oxygen for medical use during the second wave, is also looking to expand oxygen production and delivery capacity. Hospitals have had time to work out rapid expansion of bed and workforce capacity. Hopefully, none of this will be required, but to go back to sleep on public health issue, healthcare issue would be a fatal mistake. It is time India made public healthcare a top priority, because as the pandemic has shown, ignoring healthcare can be fatal to both people and economy. We must not indulge in a blame game and realize that pandemic is about humanity and virus. Thanks to accelerating learning by our healthcare system and increased pace of vaccination, it appears that we are now on the verge of winning. We have an excellent panel to explore what needs to be considered and done for our healthcare system. Diwali is just 42 days away. Let us all hope that lights will shine brightly and millions like us, saved by global response and God's grace, can celebrate with precautions. Thank you very much, and I will now request Ms. Sunita Reddy to conduct the session.
Well, thank you very much for that introduction to the session. I think the fact that IIMA has chosen health as one of its first session is the fact that the world is giving health a lot of importance, and rightly so, because at the foundation of any economy, at the foundation of the happiness of a nation, is truly the status of the healthcare of that nation. As we all know, India had invested 1.25% of its GDP in healthcare. Recommendations were there to move it to 2.5%. And I think this crisis has shown that now more than ever before, that this is the time that we work together to collaborate. And I'm truly blessed to be with such a powerful group of people, all of whom are doctors. In fact, I'm the only one who's not a doctor. So I think this coming together of people, whether you're, you know, doctors, whether you're people in management, whether you're just housekeeping staff or a nurse, this or just part of the government, this collaboration of people coming together for the sake of the cause is what made us really win in times of COVID. And India did have the lowest mortality rates. And I think credit to the government and credit to everyone who really played a unique role. So over the next 20 minutes, I hope to cover several sessions that will cover maybe a vaccination program, how insurance has changed and how the demand for insurance has become an important part of the future of health. And what can we do to improve health infrastructure and skilling, something that Dr. Devi Shetty has spoken so much about. And finally, is this a pandemic or an endemic, and how is the future going to look like? So with that, let me start with my first question to Dr. Azad Moopen. Doctor, we know that, you know, you've built health systems not only in India, but in many geographies. So my question to you is, you know, what are the strengths, the distinctive strengths of each, and what would you bring to India, or what would you take from India to the rest of the world?
Thank you very much. Thanks a lot for that question. And so when I look at our situation in India, I think that we have done a good job and we are in a good place now, but we had challenges in the middle. But as has been mentioned by you, one of the most important things which I feel when we look at the, I sit outside of India, and when I look at India, I feel that one of the most important things that we should be doing is to allocate more towards healthcare. Like what you said, the government spend is 1.5% of GDP, which they plan to take to 2.5% by 2025. That's what the government had said. And that is very minuscule when compared to many of the Western countries. Europe spends 10%, America spends 17%. And even our neighbors like Bangladesh and all spends 3 to 4% for healthcare. So the long and short of this is that we have to spend more if we have to have a good healthcare system. So I think one of the most important things for national health security, which is as important as any other security, I think, is to have more of spend by the government. And of course, the private sector also will follow suit. Now, that is being done in the countries where we sit. And I think that that's a very important thing which has to be done. Another very important thing which I felt is that the requirement for the capacity building, which again goes to the resources which is available, money, as well as the focus of the government on that. We have to have much more numbers coming, and I'm sure that Dev Shetty will be speaking on that. That is very important, that pipeline of doctors, nurses, paramedics. I think we struggled a lot because we didn't have that. And then, of course, the third most important thing I'll say is that there's a requirement for us to take up digital transformation in a big way. That's the only way in which we can, in India, with 1.4 billion population, reach the periphery and provide healthcare to the people. It's impossible almost if we look at using the physical means of reaching people. So this is what I have to say as an opening remarks from my side to your question.
Thank you very much. I think very useful remarks and a segue into my question for Dr. Devi Shetty. Dr. Devi Shetty, you know, all of us have read about your thoughts about skilling. So I'm going to move to something that I think we need to understand deeply, and that is the payer model. You introduced Yashashwini, a very successful scheme, micro insurance scheme in rural Karnataka. So let me ask you, where do you think we can get to in terms of scale, coverage, and depth of insurance, as well as customer satisfaction? And just as a related question, what is your take on payer formats potentially affecting the quality of care? You know, because all of us are very concerned that care should never be compromised. So please give us your views.
Thanks. Thank you so much, Sunita. First of all, one of the greatest missing link in Indian healthcare today is that significant percentage of the population pay from the pocket. That has to be addressed, and a financial intermediary should emerge. Now, this financial intermediary need not necessarily be a IRDA approved insurance program, because the moment you go in that route, all the rules of the games are already fixed. You have no leeway to maneuver or innovate. I believe that the poor people in the country, fortunately, are covered by the Ayushman Bharat government scheme, which is doing a wonderful job. And the rich people have a traditional health insurance, or they may not need any insurance. They can pay from the pocket. Large number of working class people drawing between 25,000 to 60,000 rupees per month. This category of people, if they want to buy a health insurance scheme, that doesn't exist today. So like we have caused the fintech revolution in so many app-based tools for the financial inclusion, we need to have such an intermediary for paying for the healthcare. It may be a targeted insurance for cancer or a heart or a surgical procedure, whatever. But that is the only way. If we have to wait for the government to offer health insurance to everyone and healthcare at free of cost, that is not going to happen. That's not a scalable model, because a country which has such a tiny percentage of the taxpayers, where is the money? So my suggestion is we need to really come up with out of the box financial intermediaries, which will pay for what it costs, not like launch a scheme and squeeze the hospital and pay them less than what it costs. That's not going to serve the purpose. The industry won't survive. So if we can come up with that kind of product, I am convinced that that will really, really transform Indian healthcare.
Thank you, Devi Shetty. Dr. Devi Shetty, you know, you're so right. only the health insurance penetration or private health insurance penetration is only 5%. And now we do have NBFCs that are offering, you know, EMIs, so people can pay for their cardiac bills, they can pay for oncology. So I think this is something that we should take very seriously. So, you know, having heard you on insurance, I want to move on to this, you know, the diagnostics and the treatment, because this is something that we were faced with during COVID. So I would like to really address the question of scale and capacity for diagnostics with Dr. Srinath Reddy. And, you know, how do you think about treatment, vaccination and diagnostics? And what is your perspective on addressing these needs on a countrywide basis? Because this is not just about Tier 1, but, you know, this is an epidemic that spread to all parts of India. So how do we scale this, and what are the critical elements we need to build scale?
Well, clearly this is an area that needs to be addressed, because not only it is important for appropriate clinical management and even for prevention, of course, but it is also one of the major contributing causes of out-of-pocket expenditure. In fact, about 70% of out-of-pocket expenditure comes from outpatient care. And out of that, a good fraction of it comes from drugs and diagnostics. And not having access to affordable diagnostics, or even having competent qualified laboratories perform diagnostics closer to home, is going to be quite a challenge. Now, of course, the government is saying that in the health and wellness centers, there is going to be a facility for basic diagnostics to be provided. But in addition, I think we ought to be really looking at point of care diagnostics. A number of possibilities exist in which diagnostic kits can be carried by the frontline health workers, and the tests can be performed at home. It's not absolutely essential that everybody has to go to a distant laboratory to get it done. But that brings into question the whole area of quality assurance. We need to build in quality assurance at all facilities, public and private, and ensure that we get affordable diagnostics easily provided as per need, as close to home as possible, with ready availability of results for quick decision making. And of course, that applies to quality assured generic drugs as well, being provided free of cost in all public facilities, and if possible, through a poor procurement system, which actually reduces the costs of procurement. Even the private hospitals can actually buy from that common pool procurement system and pass on the benefit to their patients as well. So we really ought to be looking at how we can actually build up good diagnostic facilities right from the sub-center level up to the medical colleges, and particularly the district hospitals as well. And I believe the government is now really looking, if you look at the budget of February 2021, and also the new schemes that are likely to be announced soon, that diagnostic facilities at multiple levels are likely to be set up, mainly triggered by the pandemic response. Because the whole idea of getting good virological diagnosis or a microbial diagnosis, of even getting the genomic testing done in order to identify variants, all of this has really given a spur to establishing diagnostics in a wide network of institutions across the country, as I said, right from the sub-center to the medical college hospital. So we do need to invest more in this facility, but simultaneously ensure that there are trained technicians, people capable of delivering competent reports with quality assurance, and ensure that this whole network is adequately coordinated at various levels.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Srinath Reddy. You know, Dr. Srinath Reddy has spoken about building wider networks. And I think that that's crucial for a country like India, where 60% of the population lives in Tier 2 and Tier 3 towns. So I think in the, you know, as we think about wider networks, as we think about skilling, because it's, you know, this is something that Dr. Devi Shetty is also passionate about. We need to train those phlebotomists. So that's one aspect of it. But I'd like to move on to you, Dr. Mupin, to hear about how do you think we can access and look after these far-flung locations, not only in terms of diagnostics, but care using the new digital economy?
Thank you,
Yeah. So thank you. I briefly touched that. So I think that is one of the most important things that we have to see. We won't be able to send doctors or nurses to these far-flung areas. So one, you will have to build manpower capacity by training people. It shouldn't be a 5-year, 3-year, 2-year, like what Dr. Shetty always tells. We should have people who are trained for maybe 6 months to 1 year, and we should have large number of trained healthcare workers who have the basic requirements to carry out the simple questioning, as well as to get some tests done, as well as to convey it to a hospital, to a doctor who is sitting maybe in the district headquarters or taluk headquarters. So that is extremely important. Then the digital connectivity. Luckily, we are in a country where we have one of the largest mobile connectivity, even in the villages. So that part is already taken care and it's becoming better with 5G and all. So now the thing is that how are we going to connect this with the district headquarters or taluk headquarters or even other hospitals which are getting into the network, and how can we get this connected and see that there is a diagnosis in a case where a patient need not come to these places, we can provide that. And of course, along with that, there is a question of the logistics. So what I feel is that apart from having this, we have to have mobile medical vans which will take these people along with some supplies for treatment and providing, and also the testing which can happen along with that. So my view, to cover the country in a planned manner over a period of maybe 5 to 10 years, we should have mobile medical services. We have to train people beyond the level of nurses and doctors. And we also have to that connectivity develop between those centers in the periphery as well as the ones in the hospitals. So that will give us that capability to address and reach the healthcare problems throughout the country.
Wonderful. So it's a combination of both digital and having and being more mobile. So that brings me to the question of flexibility for you, Dr. Shetty. In your own persona, you're very flexible. I know you're a cardiac surgeon, plus you're chairman of Narayana Hridayalaya. So I can see the dexterity that exists within you. So all of us have worked to create a system, you know, during the second wave, all of us have worked to create a system that dealt with both COVID patients as well as the regular patients, because we couldn't keep them, you know, on hold much longer. And we couldn't waste a minute. So when we think of the future, how do you think, what is your vision of creating a flexible healthcare system that manages to deal with both these airborne diseases? Right now it's COVID-19, but it could be something else that comes later, as well as the NCDs, which are all, you know, which is something that is there. 50% of India has a problem with NCDs. So how do you think about this?
Thanks, Sunita. First of all, we should assume that there will be many more viruses like COVID, which is going to create trouble in the future. There is no doubt about it, because like COVID, there are at least another few hundred viruses lurking inside the bodies of animals in the forest. It's a matter of time before they find their way to a human body. Now, if a situation like this arises in the future, the best way to manage is by having one group of young doctors who comprise a mobile workforce, because fortunately, COVID doesn't infect the whole country at one time. COVID first started in Kerala, then it went to other states. So it keeps on going from one state to the other state. And at the peak, the peak lasts not more than 1 or 2 months. They just need maximum number of doctors and nurses, young doctors and young nurses, only during that period. So if you have a young mobile workforce of maybe 20,000, 50,000 young doctors, nurses, medical technicians, we can cover most of the public hospitals. Because the biggest problem we face today is, since independence, government hospitals always had over 70% shortage of medical specialists. We haven't been able to fill up those vacancies, in spite of which government is in power. So a mobile flexible workforce will make a huge, huge difference. And about the communicable, non-communicable diseases, Only fortunately, these are chronic diseases which can be managed online. We have over 10,000 patients who are managed, 10,000 diabetics who are managed online by our diabetologist. And they have produced a very impressive document of how patients who are managed online, their glycemic control is much better than patients who insisted on visiting the doctors. This is the beauty of technology, because with the digital route, we can keep nudging these patients to get the blood sugar tested regular intervals, send us a report. If they don't, we keep on barraging them with the SMSs. So essentially, future is not an extension of the past. 10 years ago, half the tools what we have never existed. So we have to change with changing times, and every rule of the game has to be redefined. And that is what matters in facing the uncertain future. Flexibility is the name of the game.
That's a really good answer. So, yes, I know digital technology has been used, especially in condition management. And like all of you rightly said, it is the future. So, you know, in the interest of time, I thought I'll move on to, we've got a lot of questions that have come in. So let me move on to these questions, because I think our listeners will be sad if I don't ask them. The first to you, Dr. Professor Srinath, do you think that insurance can relieve the government of its burden of providing public health services?
I do not think so. Let me be very clear. Insurance can support the system, but most of the funding has to come from tax revenues. It has to be centrally funded. And that's true of virtually every country in the world which has attempted anything close to universal health coverage, from 84% in the UK to even 48% in the United States. It is public financing. Private insurance or contributory insurance, particularly from salary deductions, is not likely to be a major contributor, because salary deductions will only account for a small level in a country where about 90% are in the informal sector. Yes, contributory insurance is a possibility, but certainly payroll deductions are not really possible at this point in time. So, as has been pointed out, we spend very little on health compared to many other countries. So we do need to increase our allocation to health and utilize it also much better with allocative and utilization efficiencies. But I don't think leaving it entirely to the insurance mechanism is going to really work in this country. It may be supplementary, but it cannot be a substitute for a tax-funded healthcare system.
So as an auxiliary to this, you know, Dr. Devi Shetty, we have another question which says, should taxpayers be asked to fund a national health scheme, given that the bureaucracy is designed for control and not service? What are your feelings, your reaction to this?
As Srinath just mentioned, bulk of the healthcare has to come from taxpayers' money. There is no other choice, because more than half the country's population today are enjoying the benefit of Ayushman Bharat, which is a taxpayer-funded scheme. But having said that, a vibrant health insurance program will add significantly to the overall development of delivery as well as the industry standards. It will only improve if there is a lot of financial intermediaries for every section of the society. In nutshell, we have to replace a person paying from the pocket. If people have to pay from the pocket, I will be surprised if a president of US is in a position to get a bypass grafting done without the financial intermediary called health insurance scheme. So how many people have 5 to 10 lakh rupees of cash money in the bank at any given time if they need a medical emergency? So essentially, we have to replace the cash part of the healthcare with the financial intermediary. It can be a government-funded health insurance scheme, or a privately funded health insurance scheme. But I am not a very strong favorite of government offering healthcare free of cost. I insisted many, many years ago, even if the test and the procedure is done free of cost in a government hospital, produce a bill at the end of the, when the patient goes home, clearly mentioning he doesn't have to pay, but there has to be a billing so that some accountability is brought into the system. And also patient knows what is the value of the ultrasound he had or the value of a gallbladder surgery or a hysterectomy she had. Today, they think that when it is free, no one pays for it. Somebody is paying for it. So essentially, we need to change the perception of the healthcare by the common man.
That's so true. And I think it has a lot, it will build trust in the healthcare system if we do that. So, you know, one of the things that what you said is very true, that we really need to let people, and the perception around the cost of healthcare is extremely important. And I think, you know, one of the suggestions that maybe later on all of us can come together is to see whether we can really make sure that meaningful premiums for healthcare are tax deductible. And if that happens, maybe there will be more people willing to take up health insurance. So Dr. Mupin, let me ask you, and I think you have a worldview sitting in Dubai. What are the chances of a third wave?
Yeah, so that's a question which anybody can speculate anything, but definitely we should be prepared for that. The good thing is that the even if a wave comes, as the people in many countries, especially in India and all, herd immunity being very high, I think the impact, it seems, will be very minimal. And in countries where it has not gone to that level, definitely there will be a third wave. But in India, I think that we are fairly well placed because of the herd immunity, which is increasing, the zero positivity, as well as, of course, the vaccination coming up. But we have to be definitely prepared. And this is going to be something which we will have to live with. It is not going to be a waves which will be. It will be a continuous, activity which will be the, continuous illness will be, which will be there in the endemic state. And we will have to live with that, with vaccination, with all the treatment. But there are a lot of things which have improved over the period of time. The severity has come down with vaccination. There are better medical methods apart from what we used to have earlier, the steroids only. Now we have the antibody cocktail, many things which can save lives. And I think that we have to take this as something with which we love to live. Whether the third wave comes, goes, or whatever, this is going to be with us for pretty long time is what I feel.
So Dr. Professor Srinath Reddy, I think Dr. Mupin has just said that third wave, there is a high likelihood and that we have to live with it. So just the other day, I read that the zero positivity of Bombay is at 72%. And India has vaccinated 15% of its people who are double vaccinated and is looking at 65% double vaccination by end of December. So what are your feelings on, you know, living with a pandemic or an endemic, or the fact that, like Dr. Devi Shetty also said, that we will always have to live with some virus? What is your feedback?
Well, let me start with some caveats and then go to a more optimistic reply. The caveats are that zero positivity in an antibody survey is not assurance of current immunity against the circulating viruses in everybody, nor is it assurance of continued immunity for several months against new viruses and variants that may come in. That's because we are only looking at antibody levels. We are not looking at their neutralizing capacity. So we do not know how much they can fight it off. And secondly, we do not know when they are going to wane off. Depending upon the amount of viral load exposure, depending on the age of the person, the general health condition of the person, we know that even these antibody levels will decline. However, having said that, and we also know that antibodies are not the only thing that signal immunity. We know that cellular immunity is there, which may not necessarily decline so fast. We also know that even if the antibodies decline, memory cells, memory T and B cells may be there, which get activated when challenged again by the virus. So there is a lot that we are still learning. But given the fact that there is evidence of a high level of viral exposure in the population, even by these antibody levels, and that our vaccination rates are stepping up, I do not think there is likelihood of a major third wave, but we cannot rule out in certain parts of the country fairly large spikes. But if we are defining the third wave in terms of the case counts of infected people, those may occur. But if we are deciding on the third wave in terms of the number of seriously ill people who are likely to be rushing to hospitals, getting into intensive care, or unfortunately losing lives, the third wave certainly will not be as devastating as the second wave.
Thank you, Dr. Srinath Reddy. So we have just 5 minutes, and I would really like to use those 5 minutes to let your imagination come up with solutions for Indian healthcare. So Dr. Devi Shetty, if you were setting the policy, the healthcare policy agenda for the next 2 years, what would be your priority?
I have the most important priority for me is skilling. And we have to understand that the educational system of our country has a basic flaw. The flaw is our educational system, whether it's a nursing, medicine, paramedics, or what engineering, whatever, this is based on parents paying for the higher education. When you talk about parents paying for the higher education, you have naturally excluded half the country's population. Because half the country's population, the parents are primarily dependent on their physical labor. And by the age of when they are in their 40s and 50s, children are about to join the college. That is the time these parents depend on the children to take care of them. But if they have to spend lakhs of rupees to educate their daughter as a nurse or a doctor, there is no way they can pay. So my suggestion is, after 10th standard, children coming from poor families who have an interest in medical education or whatever in the medical area, there should be a parallel education for them inside a hospital where they are trained at no cost by the hospital, initially as a ANM, auxiliary nursing midwife, for 2 years, then as a GNM, and the entire education is sponsored by the hospital. But in return, this girl or a boy works in the hospital for 8 hours a day, 48 hours a week. And they have, most of the education happens online, like what has happened across the world for 2 years. You mean to say, if we do not trust online education, what have we done in the last 2 years? So we should do that. And a GNM, if she ever decides to become a doctor, there has to be a stream for her to join MBBS course. So essentially, unless we replace the parent-paid education, believe me, you will not be able to send half of our children to the institution of higher education.
Yes, I think many parents will be relieved to hear that, as well as it will definitely be something meaningful for society. Let me ask you, Dr. Azad Moopen, what is a policy initiative that you would suggest, and maybe with a global lens?
Yeah, so I have a couple of points. One, we have to definitely increase the GDP spent to healthcare to about 4% within the next 2 to 3 years, because we really, really require that for sprucing up the whole healthcare system in India. One. Second one, I think that there is an opportunity if we make the doctors who come out after the house surgency, before they go into PG, for 2 or 3 years, every year about 100,000 doctors come out, 70 or 80,000, whatever it is. If we make them go into the rural service, that will definitely help. One, that will help the rural service. And second, that will also help them to get a view before they go for a post-graduation. And the third, I think, like the other services, like the IAS, the IRS, the IPS, and all the other civil services, we should have an Indian medical service also being developed. Indian medical service, if it is being given a chance with selection of doctors or medical management people who come into that, will form the core of such a situation of a national emergency where the national disaster can be addressed by them much more effectively than being managed by others. So we should look at an Indian medical service for us in the future to, sort of address such issues as well as to look at the future of the Indian healthcare.
So very brilliant ideas. Thank you, Dr. Mupin. Finally, Dr. Srinath Reddy, you really have the opportunity to set the policy agenda. You've heard all of us. And so tell me, what would you do?
Well, I would focus very strongly on creating a very strong primary healthcare system, not only in rural areas, but urban areas. It has to be comprehensive primary healthcare. It has to address both acute and chronic conditions. It has to be also connected primary healthcare bidirectionally to good secondary and tertiary care facilities. But our health system will actually not advance unless we bring in a strong primary healthcare system, which can take care of many of the problems before they advance to very severe disease. At the same time, this has to be really propelled by training a large number of frontline healthcare workers who are technology enabled and who can provide a lot of services. And primary healthcare need not be mostly doctor dependent. But certainly, in terms of requiring other types of healthcare professionals at various levels, we should strengthen our district hospitals and make them into training centers for allied health professionals, nurses, and doctors, and ensure that many of the underserved districts now are appropriately served with the new medical colleges. And unless we build up these network of institutions, but particularly focusing on strong primary healthcare systems, we'll be faltering.
Thank you very much. So, ladies and gentlemen, I would really like to thank the members of this esteemed panel. Not only do they come up with individual entrepreneurial ideas, but they actually have the ability to implement them. And it's been a privilege to be in dialogue with them. I thank you all for listening in on this session. Good evening.
Thanks.